Let's go to the Word of God together, John chapter number 21. As you get your Bibles, let's turn to the 21st chapter of the Gospel of John. John chapter number 21, beginning in verse number 14. We've been here now since Easter. Easter, we began a series called Restored, and the Lord has been leading us week by week, day by day, as we look at the restoration of Peter, and we compare that to the restoration of the body of Christ, leading us up to the day of Pentecost. So I'm going to continue that conversation with you today in the 21st chapter of the book of John, chapter number 21, verse number 14. And again, check in on Facebook. If you're watching on Facebook, let us know that you're watching. And comment, type amen. And we're just together as the family. And so I want to see what the Lord is speaking to your heart about. John chapter 21, verse 14. Now, this is the third time, John said, that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. When they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these?" He said unto him, "Yea, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him again the second time, "Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know that I love you." So he said, "Feed my sheep." Verse 17, he said to him the third time, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me?" Now, Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Lovest thou me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said unto him, "Feed my sheep. Verily I say to you, when you were young, you girdest yourself and walked wherever you would. But when you're going to be old, you shall stretch forth your hands, and another is going to gird and carry thee where thou wouldest not." And he spake this, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said unto Peter, him, he said, "Follow me, follow me." I'm going to read a couple more verses because this is significant. Peter turned and he saw the disciple who Jesus loved, which is John, also leaned on his breast at supper and said, "Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee?" And Peter said to the Lord, he said, "Lord, what is this man going to do?" Verse 22, Jesus said to Peter, "If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to you? Follow thou me." In other words, Peter, it's none of your business what he's doing. I want you to follow me. Amen. You may be seated. Welcome home. Amen. We're coming back as the body of Christ stronger than we've ever been. And we have entered into this next phase of what the nation has called the COVID-19 crisis, but what the world calls a crisis, God calls an opportunity. And the Lord has used what the world is going through right now as an opportunity to expand his kingdom. But we're entering into this next phase where the world around us is beginning to open back up. Businesses are beginning to open back up. Restaurants soon will begin to open back up. Restrictions are being lifted. People will be able to come out of their homes like groundhogs coming out of their hole. And we're going to see people scurry about. And the governor of Indiana on Friday put out the plan of opening the state back up. And he laid it out very well, the different phases of opening up. And part of that plan was that worship services, indoor worship services, would again be opened up beginning on May the 8th. And I know the mayor of South Bend doesn't like that and has totally disagreed with him. We'll see how all that plays out. But the fact is, the world around us is now beginning to adopt what they are calling a new normal. Talking about what it's going to look like when restaurants open up. What are sporting events going to look like? Are you going to have to sit 6 feet apart at Notre Dame Stadium to watch a Notre Dame football game? I guarantee that's not going to happen because they would lose too much money if that happened. People are looking at the world in a different way now. What's going to be opening up? What does that mean? What does that look like? How does that feel? How is our country going to be different after COVID-19 than it was before COVID-19? But I want to tell you, We've had a taste of what a socialistic government looks like, and honestly, I don't like the taste of it, and I never want to taste it again. We've had a taste of what government control looks like, what fear, what control, what manipulation looks like. We've had a taste of people buying into everything that the news media tells them and accepting it as fact. And I'm going to tell you, it's not a taste that we ever need to taste again. I pray that we as Americans appreciate our freedom more now than we ever have. And I don't want to get too far off of my notes, but I want to tell you something, friend. God has blessed America with freedom, and we cannot let that freedom go just because somebody says we have to. All right? That's not the topic of my message. That's going to be coming up. But I'm telling you, we are opening up. The body of Christ, the nation, the world is opening up again. But I'm not as concerned about what the world looks like, how that's going to change, as much as I am how the church is going to change as a result of opening up, what that looks like as the body of Christ. Because to this point, we've been scattered. Like the disciples after the death of Christ and even after the resurrection, we've been scattered. We've been dispersed. We've been in our own homes, unable to gather, unable to do what we normally do when it comes to ministry. And as hard as it's been for all of us, I believe God has used it for a good thing. Because you see, every season that we walk through in life, God has a reason for every season. And I believe that as I just get into this, I want to put some precursors out here. I believe that this has been a season for us to evaluate who we are. It's been a season where we as the body of Christ, we as the church, have been able to step back and really look at who we are, because for far too long, we have bought into a mentality of just doing church the way we've always done it. And we've done things, whether they're really the right thing or not, we've just done it out of habit. We've done it because, well, that's the church that I grew up in. That's how they did it. That's how they did it years ago. But the reality is, this has been a wake-up call. This has been a wake-up call for the church to evaluate, who are we? And again, that's why from the beginning of this series, I've been comparing Peter's restoration to the restoration of the church. Because again, it was the confession of Peter. Go to Matthew chapter number 16, that confession where Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh, blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven." And then Jesus said, "You're Peter, and upon this rock, this confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." This is the prophetic declaration of Jesus prophesying the beginning of the church, the New Testament church, which would open up as we are, open up on the day of Pentecost. The New Testament church would be born. Now, it's significant, though, that Jesus uses this phrase when he said, "The gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And I know many times, you know, we read that and we really don't think about why Jesus said that. We shout about it, but think about it. In the context of biblical understanding, biblical cities all had gates. Gates were significant to these cities. Even in the old city of Jerusalem, even now, there are gates by which you enter into the old city. These gates were significant in the fact that the elders of the city, they would gather at the gates, and the transactions and the business of the city would be done at the gates of the city. They would make plans that would affect the city. They would make schemes, and they would make agendas that would affect the city. So gates were very, very significant. Now, let me ask you a question. If that city would go on a military attack against another city, do you think the army picked up the gates and took the gates with them on that attack? Absolutely not. And so when Jesus said that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, many times many believers take that as, yeah, when the devil attacks me, when hell comes against me, he's not got. That's not what it means. For you see, when Jesus said the gates of hell, he is telling the church, rather than be on the defensive and wait for the enemy to attack you, I believe the Lord is prophesying to the church that we are to go on the offensive rather than be on the defensive. Let me tell you something, church. I believe for far too long we have tucked our heads in the sand and not known who we are as the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have been on the defensive and we have just accepted every arsenal that has been fought against us. And we say, oh, by the grace of God, I'm just holding on day by day. I'm just holding on. Listen, stop just holding on and pick up the armor of God. Pick up the sword of the Spirit and go on the offensive, because there are tactics and schemes and agendas that have been schemed at the gates of hell that are trying to be infiltrating into the church and into our country. And I believe personally that this is the time that God has said, you need to evaluate who you are. You are the blood-bought body of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's time for you to get up, go on the offensive against the schemes and the agendas of hell that have been deemed by the devil to try to destroy the church and destroy this nation, and realize that we are more than conquerors through the Lord Jesus Christ. How many believe it? Shout amen. We need to evaluate. We need to look at who we are and understand that we've been given the authority of the name of Jesus to come against every scheme, every agenda, every plan of the enemy. And rather than be reactive, how about we be proactive in the name of our Savior? Amen. To evaluate. Now, what does that mean? Also, not only just a season to evaluate who we are, but I believe it's also a season to eliminate what we don't need. Because when you truly come to an understanding of who you are, that means there's a lot of stuff that we've been doing that simply needs to be eliminated. And I think, and I've said this the last several weeks, and I'm going to continue as we move forward to preach and teach, a lot of things the church has been doing ministry with that simply aren't necessary. They're good ideas, but as we come into this season, it is a different season than we have ever been in. And I believe that when we understand who we are going on the offensive, that means we need to shed some extra weight that has been holding us back from making the offensive progress that we need to make. You know, when Paul the Apostle wrote to the Hebrews, he said, wherefore, we're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. What do we do? He said, let us lay aside every weight and sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. I believe it is significant, the differentiation that the apostle makes between weight and sin, meaning that there's some things that are not necessarily sinful, but yet they are weights that are holding you back from the progress that God wants you to make in chasing the destiny that he's planned for you. Church, I believe that there have been some things that have been holding the church back from really being the body of Christ that we are destined to be. And some of the weights, they're not sin, they're not bad, they may be decent ideas, but listen, we're living in the hour of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we don't have time to be messing around with weights that are impeding the progress of reaching the world with the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, because we are on the cusp of the rapture of the church, and there is such an urgency in my spirit to not waste any time or any moment on things that have no eternal significance. Let's get back to being the body of Christ. Let's get back to standing with the Word of God. Let's shed every weight. Let's shed everything that is impeding our progress, and let's be who God has called us to be. Amen. You understand what I'm saying today? That's what this season has been, a season of separation, a season of being scattered. Now, I pray that you as an individual have done the same thing. I believe the Lord has allowed this time where you've had extra time. Maybe you've not been working. You've not been able to go out to eat. You've not been able to go watch the Cubs play. You've not been able to do all of these things. The Lord has allowed that so you can look at who you are as an individual. Listen, the time for you to walk into your God-given destiny is right now. Shed the weight, shed the sins, shed the things that are stopping you from being who God has called you to be. That's what this season has been. So as we walk now into this welcome home phase, this opening up phase, as Peter was, this again, as I've told you, is the first time that Peter has encountered Jesus after the resurrection. And this was, in essence, Jesus welcoming Peter home to the destiny and the calling that he had placed upon him leading up to the day of Pentecost. On the day of Pentecost, Peter is the one preaching. 3,000 people get saved. Holy Ghost poured out. The New Testament church is born. The same is happening for us. Amen. I believe leading up to the day of Pentecost, May 31st, we are going to see an outpouring of the Holy Ghost just as they did on the day of Pentecost, and the Holy Ghost is pushing a divine reset button, a reset, a rebirth of the church in the 21st century. So I look at this as Peter's coming home. So let's walk through this welcome home that Jesus is giving to Peter, and let's see that as we physically gather back into the house of God, what are we coming home to? Let's take a look together. Look in verse number 16. Jesus said to Peter, he said, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, yea, Lord, you know that I love you. So he said unto him, feed my sheep. The first thing that I want to show you is this. We are coming home to a greater sense of purpose. We are coming home to a greater sense of purpose. You know what's interesting to me is that Jesus does not address him in this verse as Peter. He addresses him as Simon, son of Jonas. Peter was the name Jesus ascribed to him back in Matthew chapter number 16. In the Greek, you know it, Petros, meaning rock, meaning stone. You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. But in this encounter, Jesus does not call him Peter. He said, Simon, son of Jonas. He reverts back to the name that Peter had before he met the Lord. I believe showing me that Peter somehow had missed the calling that Jesus had placed upon him to be a rock, to be strong, to be steadfast. Amen. You know, Peter had denied the Lord 3 times. He had gone and said, I'm going to go fishing. I'm going to leave all of this. He had missed the calling. And so this now is the opportunity that Jesus is bringing Peter back to his calling. And what is his calling? He said, your calling is to feed my sheep. Peter, your calling is to now feed those that I have called in now to this last day's ministry of the church. Listen, church, we've been doing a lot of things. And I say we, I mean the church globally, nationwide. We've been doing a lot of things, but I wonder how we've been doing in feeding people the word of Almighty God. Because let me tell you something, church. There's a lot of people that because of COVID-19, they have questions. They have questions that they are demanding answers to. And the question is not is when the vaccine's going to come out or not what the WHO says that I'm supposed to do. They've got questions about eternity. They've got questions about Jesus. They've got questions about heaven and about hell. I believe the Lord has awakened and aroused a hunger within so many people in this nation about the things of God. And that is the reason why when we come home, we've got to shed everything that in some way is not feeding people the truth of the word of Almighty God. We have a responsibility to answer the questions, not according to human knowledge, but according to supernatural divine wisdom that comes from the word of Almighty God. Amen. I know you say, but pastor, that's your job. You're the guy that gets up there and preaches. You're the guy that feeds us. No. You are all kings and priests unto God. Amen. That's what the word of God has called you. And I believe it is a responsibility of every child of God to have the word within them so that they can feed somebody that comes with questions about eternity. Amen. He didn't just call pastors to make disciples. He called believers to make disciples. Amen. It is the will of God for every single one of us to be on task with the purpose of feeding people the truth of the word of God. Amen. Look at your husband, look at your wife, look at your kids, say, that's for you. Every one of us have a divine responsibility. Oh, church, listen, I've got to hammer that home again. When we come back, we're gonna be excited. We're gonna shake hands. We're gonna have a great time of celebration. We've got so many things planned. We've got a big banner we're putting out, free coffee, free donuts. Oh, we're gonna have a great time. But you know what? I'm not wanting you to come back so that you can sit on the pew and be fed week after week after week after week and go out and do nothing. I'm calling the church to come back to the purpose of being fed here and then going out and taking what you have and feeding somebody else. Amen. Listen, now pardon me for being blunt, but listen, we've got a church that has become spiritually fat on teachings and sermons and inspiration, and we sit there and we eat and we eat and we eat and we never give out. That day's got to stop. That day's got to stop. On the job, you have a responsibility to feed somebody. In the neighborhood, in the coffee shop, wherever you are, you and I have a responsibility to make disciples. Amen. But here's the deal. You can't give what you don't have. You can't give what you don't have. This same Peter in Acts chapter 3 walks in with the writer of the gospel into the temple by the gate beautiful, sees a man that is lame on his feet from his mother's womb. Sees him lame, and what does Peter say? He says, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. In other words, I don't have silver, I don't have gold, but I do have what you need. In the name of Jesus, Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the Bible said his ankle bones became strong, and he shouted and he danced all over the place. Church, what am I telling you? When you and I get to the place where we are receiving from the Holy Ghost and from the Word of God, there is an anointing that I believe God is placing upon you, that you have the authority to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. You have the authority to cast out demons. You have the authority, amen, to feed this world the truth of the word of Almighty God. I know you say, but Pastor, I need to bring them to you. No, you have the authority. And that's why the church has become so anemic. It's because the church has become an entertainment complex where we get fed spiritual nachos and fries every Sunday and every Wednesday. And then we go out and live however we want to. Listen, those days are over. It cannot be that way anymore. I feel passionate about what I am preaching because the Lord is drawing the church to a greater sense of purpose. And realize your purpose is not to come and have a spiritual party. Your purpose is to be fed so you can feed somebody else. Hallelujah. That's why moving forward, home life groups are going to be so strategic. They are going to be a huge component of ministry within the body of Christ here at Christian Center. And the reason is because you can have a group of 10 to 12 people that will gather together and open up the Word of God and begin to discuss and begin to feed the Word, amen, one to another. But let me tell you this, the primary reason we are having these home groups is so that in each group, someone can rise from that group and go start their group. Because you see, we're entering into a season of multiplication. And that's how the church is going to multiply. It's so neat because the last several weeks, that word multiply has been part of the conversation of our ministry staff as we gather together and we talk about plans moving forward. Multiply keeps coming up in the conversation. And then on Friday, I had a sit-down conversation with Pastor Tyler Rhodes' dad, Pastor Danny Rhodes, from the great state of Georgia. And he came, and the Lord had just given him a word. And the word was about multiplication. confirming what we have already talked about. Because you see, in the beginning, Acts chapter 2, the Bible said that the Lord added to the church daily. But as you get further into the book of Acts, what do you see happening? Acts chapter 9, you see the churches not just being added to, but the Bible said they were multiplied. Let me tell you something right now, and I feel this in the very core of my spirit. God is getting ready to bring multiplication to this church, not multiplication so that we can brush ourselves and say, hey, what a great thing that we're doing. Multiplication because Jesus is coming and there are souls that are lost, dying, and going to hell. And we've got to realize it is time for us to see a bigger vision and see this place packed with people that are pressing in to touch the hem of the garment of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, my God, help us. Let me tell you something as well, and I just feel this is not in my notes, but I felt it come up in my spirit. The reason these home groups are going to be such a strategic part is because, let me tell you something, church, what we've gone through in the last 8 weeks is a very elementary level of the government coming against the church. Don't tune me out, but there's more coming. And we have got to be willing to stay connected within a home group setting, because you know what? No edict and no statement of government will ever stop the living church of the Lord Jesus Christ, because the living church is going to rise. We have got to come back to our purpose, and that is to feed the world. Feed them. Feed them. Oh, I want you to get this into your spirit. To feed them. God's giving us a greater sense of our purpose. But number two, along with that, Jesus said to Simon Peter, he said, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said, yeah, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, feed my sheep. Number two, welcome home not just to a greater sense of purpose, but to a deeper level of passion. He said, Simon, do you love me? Now, whether when he said love me more than these, some say he was referring to the other disciples. Some say he was referring to the fish. Do you love me more than fishing? Boy, that's a tough call for some guys. Do you love me more than these disciples? It doesn't matter who he was talking about. The question that Jesus was asking Peter, before you go out and fulfill your purpose, I have to know that you love me. Do you love me? Is there a passion? Is there a passion that you have? Because you see, purpose without passion is meaningless and without direction. We can do all sorts of things, but if we don't have the motivation, a passion and love for the Lord Jesus Christ behind what we do, we might as well not even do it. That's why Paul said to the Corinthians, he said, listen, I can speak with the tongues of men and angels, but if I don't have love, I'm just like a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. I could stand and have the gift of prophecy. I could understand all mysteries and have all knowledge. I could even have all faith so that I could remove mountains. But if I don't have love, Paul said, I am nothing. I could give all of my goods to feed the poor. I could give my body to be burned. But if I don't have love, it profiteth me nothing. What is the Bible telling us, church? What am I telling you? I'm telling you that when we come back, we've got to come back so focused on falling in love with Jesus more than we have ever loved him before. I'm talking about a passionate love. I'm talking about a demanding love. I'm talking about a love that is beyond the affections of friendship, but a love that comes from the core of your spirit where you say, Jesus, I want to do ministry because I love you. Amen. Jesus said, Peter, I don't want you feeding my sheep until I know that you love me. I believe the Lord is saying, I don't want you singing on the worship team until I know that you love me. I don't care how talented you are. I don't care if you've been singing in a group for 25 years. If you don't love Jesus, I don't want you singing on the worship team. The Lord is saying, I don't want you working in Sea Kids You may have more degrees than a thermometer in children's ministry and child education. Don't do it unless you love me. Because you see, I believe, and this is what I felt like the Lord gave me, we're entering into a season where those who have done ministry with the wrong motivation are going to be removed and replaced by those whose driving purpose is a passion for the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe we are entering into a time when pastors are going to be removed from the pulpits because their motivation has been to become popular and to make money off of their preaching. There are going to be worship leaders that will be removed from the platform because their passion has been to entertain the body of Christ with their musical expertise. God is moving politicians out of office and replacing them with righteous men and women. And there is a divine transfer that is going on in this season right now where God is saying, I am putting in place men and women that have a passion for me and a passion for my word, and everybody else is going to be removed because this is the last day's revival. Hallelujah. Pardon me for getting excited. I know we're online, but man, I am fired up right now. There is something that is going on in the realm of the Spirit that is unknown to men. There's going to be individuals that have no idea why they've been removed out of their positions. There's going to be lifetime politicians that in November are going to be voted out. And they're going to say, what in the world happened? I'll tell you what happened. The Holy Ghost moved on the church because he is rising. And things are happening now to extend the body of Christ and the kingdom of God. Listen, we've got to love Jesus now more than ever before. It's got to be passionate. Because the Lord asked him three times. And you that have studied this passage know, but when he asked him the first two times, Jesus and Peter used two different words. When Jesus said, Simon, do you love me? Jesus uses the Greek word agape. Agape is a God-like divine love that is all-giving, uncaused, that is unselfish. But when Peter answered him, he said, Lord, you know I love you. Peter used a different word. He used the Greek word philio, which is a more reciprocal love, a friendly affection. In fact, there's some translations that actually express Peter's answer as, I am your friend. Jesus wasn't asking Peter to be his friend. Jesus was asking Peter to be his follower. And don't fall out with me on this. I know we sing that song, I am a friend of God. I get what we're talking about. But I'm telling you, there's some people that are my friends that I don't love as much as my family. Oh, we're affectionate. We get along. I'll have coffee. But you know what? My love for that person is not nearly as deep. And I believe the same is true when it comes to this new season of ministry. God is saying, listen, I'm calling those who don't want to just be friendly and affectionate with me. I want them to love me with all of their heart, all of their soul, all of their mind, and to come in and just let it go and let the love of God flow. That's what he's calling us back to. Oh, God, I pray that you embrace this moment right now, because I'm telling you everything that I feel like the Lord has downloaded into my spirit. God is calling us away from the casual, away from the convenient, into a deeper level of devotion for him, a level that draws us into a place of prayer. This week, there was a morning, it wasn't even my usual time that I pray, but I felt like the Lord was drawing me, compelling me. I was in the middle of doing something else, and I felt such a compelling from the Holy Ghost to get into that place of prayer. And I felt like God was showing me we're coming into the season where at any time you could be in the middle of anything, but God wants you to love him so much you will drop what you are doing, and you're going to go spend time with him. Oh, I feel right now the anointing just reaching out And for those that will receive this, God will bring you into that deeper level of devotion. He will bring you into that deeper level of anointing. He will bring you into that deeper level of intimacy with Him. Listen, I'm talking about an intimate fellowship with Almighty God. What a privilege to be in the presence of the Creator of the universe and to lift my hands and to worship Him and to pray and to commune with Him and Him with me. My God, church, do you understand? Understand how important this is at this time in history. Peter, do you love me? Church, do you love me? Is that what Jesus is calling out? You know, it's funny how Jesus asked the same question three times. And the third time the Bible said, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved. Why was he grieved? Because he knew exactly why Jesus asked him three times. He knew that Jesus used the same amount of times to ask him, do you love me? As the same amount of times that Peter had denied him. Peter knew that Jesus was saying, Peter, Simon, will you love me with the same amount of passion that you denied me with? Because Peter was passionate, cursing and swearing, said, I know not the Lord. And now Jesus is saying, I want you to now take that passion and that emotion, and I want you to transfer it over, and I want you to love me passionately, passionately. The third thing that I want to show you, and I'm getting ready to close here. Welcome home to a deeper, a greater sense of purpose. When we come home, welcome home to a deeper level of passion. But number three, welcome home to a higher position of power. We're in John 21. So if you've got your Bible, take John 21, turn the page. If you're on your iPad, press next. What do you come to? Acts chapter 1. What is the next event after this welcoming home of Peter by the Lord? The next event is verse 4 of chapter 1 of Acts. Being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart. Depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Verse 8, he said, you will receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you will be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea. And in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. The first mandate Jesus gave to these disciples was not to draw up the constitution and bylaws for the new church. He did not tell them to get out the blueprints, to draw up a schematic plan for the first building that they would have. But rather, he said, the first thing you have to do is to wait and to pray until you are endued with power of the Holy Ghost. And of course, we know that happened in the second chapter of Acts as they had gathered and the day of Pentecost was fully come and they were with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound out of heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Jesus said, I don't want you doing anything until you are filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Church, listen, when we come physically back, I am not going to lay out a schematic ministry plan for the rest of 2020. I'm not going to come back and unveil the drawings we have for the sanctuary remodel. I'm not going to give you a bunch of different things that we will do for the rest of the year. From now until the day of Pentecost, May 31st, we are going to pray and we are going to believe for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost like the disciples had in the upper room. We are going to pray that on May 31st, we experience the same outpouring of the Holy Ghost, where everybody that is not filled with the Spirit will feel the endowment of power from on high, and they will begin to speak in a tongue that they know not, and the power and the authority of the Holy Ghost will come upon them, because we as the body of Christ, as we move into this season, we are going to be filled with the Spirit, amen. I'm not talking about crazy, kooky stuff. I'm talking about a genuine, authentic infilling of the Holy Ghost, walking in the power and the endowment from on high, because I believe that this is the divine reset that God is doing in the body of Christ. He said, I don't want you walking in human wisdom. I don't want you walking in human understanding. I don't want you walking with worldly knowledge. I want you walking full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. My God, as you begin to see the apostles, as they did church after the day of Pentecost, man, it was just the shadow of Peter that healed the sick. There was such an anointing upon him that it wasn't even his touch. It was his shadow that brought healing. My God, church, we can be full of the Holy Ghost. And when you walk into Starbucks, the entire environment can change. When you walk into the factory, the atmosphere can be altered. Why? Because of the Holy Ghost living within you, amen. Can I challenge you? Your days of being just one of the boys is over. Hanging around the water cooler when they tell dirty jokes and you kind of get that sheepish look on yourself and they say nothing. Brother, when you walk into the break room and they're telling a dirty joke, they ought to stop because of the presence of God that is within you. They ought to be arrested because of the anointing of God that is upon you. What am I saying, church? We're walking into a greater level of power than we have ever walked. And for those that are hungry, for those that are thirsty, for those that want the infilling of the Holy Ghost, you will receive. You will receive. Because Peter stood on the day of Pentecost. He said, this promise is unto you and your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. I know you say, Pastor, but I wasn't raised in a church that taught about the Holy Ghost. Listen, it doesn't matter. The promise is for every blood-bought believer to be filled with the Spirit of God. And I am believing for our children. I am believing for our grandchildren. On the day of Pentecost, I want to see teenagers around the altar with their hands lifted and the Holy Ghost coming on them and them being filled with his power. I believe that Impact Student Ministries is going to see teenagers that are filled with the Holy Ghost, that are filled with his power. Listen, this is the church that God is calling us to be. Welcome home. Welcome home. And I want you to pray with me. Over the course of the next few weeks as we get towards May the 31st, the day of Pentecost, pray with me that we see an outpouring, oh God, an outpouring of his Spirit. And that it not be just something that causes us to shout and dance in the moment, but it's something that changes us forever. Are you with me? Are you with me? I want you right now, even if you're at home, I want you to stand right where you are.